please join me in welcoming him.
So hopefully, can you guys hear me? It's kind of low. I was asked to do this presentation. I haven't done one in this format. This is new to AOE, so it's going to be a learning environment for all of us here. So it's called Around the Horn. It's supposed to get engagement and communication amongst everybody. I know how that is as an attendee. You kind of like to sit and just hang out. I just did it the last presentation. So that's not the format here. We're supposed to kind of share our ideas. So I encourage all of you to participate. I'm sure you will. So really, the agenda, just to review the format, discuss current topics that are transitionally changing, just a quick overview, and then really do some case studies is what we're supposed to do, and kind of share information amongst ourselves is kind of what all of you have done and what we've experienced. I'll do a case study that Signature has did on an innovation that we've done, and then we'll try to get feedback from all of you guys on some other innovations. Like I said, this is a new approach. The goal is to get interaction. And we'll see how it goes, but this is something new for this forum or conference. The objectives, I kind of briefly went over that. So I thought just briefly, just kind of review kind of the healthcare changes. I'm not going to say anything you guys already don't know. All you guys live this every day. This is why we're aging and losing our hair and turning gray, right? When you write it down, it actually is pretty dramatic how much change has happened in most of our short careers or long careers. Technology, just kind of categorizing it, obviously the transition from analog to digital has been, a big change. Paper charts to EMR was a huge change for orthopedic surgeons. We live it still. There's not the perfect EMR. I'm sure you guys have constant complaints. Portals is something new that a lot of you have probably challenged with, maybe found some success with, but maybe not. Online access, patients online, getting into your information, sharing information from an online standpoint. Kiosk, tablet automation, have all of you looked at some of that? There's a ton of vendors around here. Is that something that you have implemented or integrated in your process? Patient expectations, their expectations have changed too. There's access, availability, high deductibles have changed what they expect out of us as providers. So, some people have adult walk-in clinics, after-hours clinics are becoming very popular from that standpoint. Communication, they're communicating with us differently via the portal, text messaging, stuff like that. Online access, we reviewed. Research prior to visit, they're not just showing up. Word of mouth is somewhat still important, but they're doing research online. We all love the wonderful patient satisfaction, health grade, vital, stuff like that, that's a constant challenge of ours. The patients historically that have the biggest issues seem to be the ones that end up on those surveys, which is just wonderful, right? then patient satisfaction surveys, patients, we're using that as tools, they're using that as tools as well. And the online reviews, like I just reviewed. Competition, that has changed to some degree as well. That's market specific probably. In some markets, hospitals have employed orthopedic surgeons, or some of them. The private practice hospitals are at war, essentially. Competition as far as just the marketing of it has become much more competitive in the environment. We've all had the quality metrics that you guys, a lot of presentations here on macro and MIPS, the meaningful use PQRS environment we've been all living. Data. Now that we've transitioned to an electronic format, we have tons of data, but what are we doing with it? We're collecting it. Do you share it with your physicians? Do you use it in the benchmarking? I'm on the benchmarking council of AOE. We have a really good participation, but we don't get every AOE member. So what are you doing with all that data in there? And then obviously the transition from volume to value. Bundle payments, commercial, Medicare, those are some of the challenges that we have gone. I'm sure I've missed some of the challenges. And innovations that have occurred, but these are some of just a quick overview. So the real question is, what have we done to adapt to these changes from an innovation standpoint, from a workflow standpoint? So I thought, we'd go over some possible case studies that kind of address some of these issues. And really the goal is to get you guys to interact. If you did a kiosk system, would you share? And I'm sure there's a ton of questions that we'd have about how your success has been from an implementation side. What vendors have you used? What success with? So we can get a real learning environment here. Before I go there, I'll just briefly start off with Signature. So Signature, the top case study is what we transitioned with our DME product in our service line. How many people distribute DMEs to their pretty much everybody, right? So, and we did too. Obviously, you understand the pros: patient convenience, revenue generator. You can pick the quality of the product you want. The cons, obviously, the challenges are storing the product, the cost, you know, making sure that you bill for all this, the products that you purchase and you sell. That leakage is a possibility that can be financially disturbing to an organization. That's what we were concerned about. We had a hard way of tracking it. So we looked at, in 2003, we transitioned to DeRoyal. So we went from multiple vendors to one unified vendor, which again was really challenging environment, because every doctor has, you know, a unique preference for this knee brace versus that knee brace. And so we kind of came to a unification on that, which most of you probably have as well. The process was good. And we used, over time, the purchasing inventory of DeRoyal system, which I don't know how many people use DeRoyal, but Bragg and those who have similar software helps you track it. A scanning gun came involved, which helped from that standpoint as well. But it really, we really couldn't tell if we were billing 100% for our charges. The only way we really knew it is when we do an inventory check, an audit, whenever we would have time to do that. And we would notice that, you know, obviously not everything got billed out. Maybe a knee brace went to a nurse's husband at home. Maybe a doctor grabbed one for his wife's carpal tunnel. Or maybe we just, human error, we just forgot to place the order on the encounter form. So in 2016, in the spring, we looked at the DeRoyal Continuum system, which is here as a vendor, and I don't want to, you know, I'm not certainly promoting them because other vendors certainly do it as well, but that was a choice that made sense for us. So just to briefly review the Continuum, does anyone else in here use the Continuum? So no one yet. So this will be a good overview then. So it's an RFID radio frequency program. So I had to find out what RFID was, but essentially you line your old DME room. In our environment, we have DME rooms. We don't have a clinic or a room where we send patients and a person applies it. Some of you may have that model. Geographically, that just doesn't work in our clinic. So if you have that model, you probably have better inventory control because your athletic trainer or nurse is applying every product on it. We don't have that, so our nurses and MAs go to a room, grab a product, come back and apply it on the patient, similar to what a lot of you do. So you line your room with this, with a lining to keep the frequency inside, make this room completely unified, no system. You install the system, and then you have an access key panel that the nurses can log in. So when I hit the keypad, it logs it in that Chad entered the room. Only one person can be in at a time. And then the other is, if you can't afford that, or you don't have a room, and you have cabinets in some of our smaller clinics, DeRoyal now has made a vault system and a cabinet that can be portable. We haven't gone that route, and I don't know the pricing from that standpoint. All the products that you currently have are assigned tags. So there's a tag attached to each product, each knee brace, each wrist splint. That, when it's inside the room, is your inventory. When you leave with that product, it reduces your inventory by one, and it assigns it to the person that entered that room. So there's 100% accountability. Yes, sir?
When the person takes that DME out of the room, do they then scan it with a barcode or
Sure. So the question was, when the person leaves a room with the product, do they have to scan it? That's the best part about this system, because it's a unified enclosed environment. RFID keeps it, the tag on it, it automatically reduces it by one, the inventory by one. But it also is tied to my, whoever entered that room's account. So now I'm accountable for it. It's in my chain of custody at this point. And then when I assign that to a patient's record, it releases it from my record, and now I know it's applied from a charge standpoint. That's a great question. So again, all employees have access codes, so all your nurses would have, you know, a four-digit access code. Only one person could be at a time, because if you came in and someone snuck behind you and they grabbed the brace and you grabbed the brace, the first person that entered would be charged with two products. It'd be assigned to them. So again, 100% accountability. When I go in, I grab the product, I come out, it's assigned to me. Then I know at the end of the day if I assign it to a record or not. The inventory is monitored real time, so I can check any time to see who has what products. I don't do it, but I could check who has what products in their chain of custody. And new products are automatically updated when received. So when DeRoyal, once you get in the system and you get all your old products with the RFID attached to it, all your new products that are shipped from DeRoyal already have the tag on it, so you don't have to worry about doing that labor. Yes, sir?
Does it work in reverse? They bring the product back because it doesn't fit,
Yep, that's a perfect example, and that's one thing we work with the Royal too, is we work with the Royal to get a tablet model with an iPad, because I know when I work the clinical side, you know, is the patient a small or medium? Sometimes you don't know, so you take two products out, you walk out, you assign one, that other one's still in my chain of custody until I walk back in the room and set it down. Once I set it back in the room, it counts it back on the inventory and it releases it from my chain of custody. So, good question. So this is just our typical room. On the left there was a door to get in the room. The only thing we installed the keypad, which is the black area down here. There's an emergency key that there's a key in it right there in that picture, but I have a key in case something happens. And then the monitor system here links to the RFID system. So the staff could actually go up there before they even enter the room and see what inventory levels for each products are in there. They could see if someone's in there, so that it warns them, so they don't waste hitting their button to let them in there, because they'll only let one person at a time. So the inside, if you see it, it's all white now. It looks very sterile, doesn't it? But all that white is the lining that we had to install. The Royal provides that lining. You just have to install it from your standpoint. We own our building in this facility, so our maintenance guy installed it. He thoroughly enjoyed it. And then they line the ceiling, the drop ceiling, with the lining too. So the whole thing has to be, so none of the frequencies leave the room. It has to be completely contained. Up in the upper right is the antenna for it, and then the green and the other power stuff is the actual RFID system. So, yes, sir.
Was it worth it?
So far it is. Yeah, I'll show you that in a little bit, yes. It looks really cool, right? Nothing changed. Our products, just like every other, we probably tidied up a little bit for the picture here, but all the products are the same except they have the RFID tags on them. So again, accountability, inventory tracking, links to the patient. The paperless process is the one that we worked with the Royal to make sure that they had an iPad tablet format so that we could assign it in the room versus having to go out to the workstation and assign it, because we'd have two products typically. The other thing we were able to do is put the paperwork, the proof of delivery on that digitally so the patient can sign it on the iPad, and then it links it into our EMR system. We have NextGen, and so that just, anytime we can cut down a paper to scan, it's a good day for us. A bunch of dashboards. I won't go through these too much, but you have dashboards. We've got inventory control, just like we did before, but it's 100% from an accountability standpoint. Audits, one thing we do every night is we actually just run a quick report to make sure that all the items were accounted for. And so we have our clinical manager do that. And if a nurse or an MA has a product in their custody and it wasn't assigned, we have a teaching moment to work with that person to make sure, did they just not return the item to the room, or did they not assign it to the patient? And then we can fix that billing error from that standpoint. So in theory, we should have 100% accuracy. Inventory value, pending restock, similar to probably what your products do. The billing, this is the report that makes sure that we were getting all of our charges put in. The unassigned report is the one that I just described, so we know who's accountable or not. The Royal has said that typically it's a 25% leakage rate is what they've seen in the industry. Again, we didn't have a great way to 100% track that. We would know when we would do inventory audits that we would have less items than we billed for from that standpoint. Vault activity, it'll show who's entered and who's not entered throughout the day. You don't really use that unless you have a situation where you're trying to track what product's missing and why it's missing. And so, has it worked was the question. So, again, we didn't really start tracking this until we kind of did the install, kind of worked out some bugs, worked with the iPad type model. In January, we started tracking, so we had 369 transactions. I know it's hard to see. We had 43 that were errors. And there were errors because a patient delivery wasn't signed, or it wasn't assigned, or it wasn't assigned. Those were all fixed, but those were ones we identified, worked with the staff by each day, kept track of the error, and fixed them. So that 43 would have been errors in the old time. Previously, that would have just been errors, and we would have potentially lost the revenue of it. So that, because it's a teachable moment, and the employees know that we're going to work with workflows, that's reduced down to 6th in February, and I don't have March's numbers at this point, but we're getting so efficient from a standpoint, they know that they're running that report to make sure that they've accounted for every product. So obviously the benefits for us have been reduction in missed proof of deliveries, reduction in missed billing. The other thing about this program is you don't have to just use DeRoyal products. If you want to manually apply, you can buy extra RFID tags and you can manually apply them, whoever does your inventory control, to any product. So we felt the high cost products such as the injectables, OrthoVist, Synvisc, we wanted to attach them to those. So obviously they're costly to purchase, but they're costly if you miss a charge as well. So we have those in that storage room, same model. When they walk in, they walk out, it assigns them to that as well. It won't reorder them, but you can do your inventory report to show that you have those. You know, we've had, obviously, our purchasing, our employee that's in charge of inventory, there's less work for her because most of it's automated. She gets a shipment, she walks in, it uploads the inventory from that standpoint. And so it's simplified that standpoint. In theory, you can have less PAR level if you want because you know you constantly have real-time inventory tracking. The tablets for us, you know, it helped reduce scanning time. We also look pretty sophisticated with the patients with this tablet, so I think it's been a win. Plus, it helps us from a workflow standpoint. We can assign it right there instead of having to go out to the workstation and assign it. Yes?
With your injection medications, are you putting one RFID on each syringe?
Well, we talked about that. Right now, we're just doing the box, and then they take it out and they assign it, and they have an area in their workstations they assign it. So there's still potential that of an error from that standpoint, but we try to keep the lot numbers, you know, in the same scenario. So, yep.
We have a similar system to what you're talking about, except it's called OrthoTrack.
Okay.
Don't know what you sold it to us.
Yeah.
And we use it a lot for our Orthotrack, which is very expensive, and we kind of took it a step further, and I do report every month what was the spend versus what was billed, and I
that's great. Anyone else use something similar? I know that DJO has one. So again, it's for the right moment, the right practice. But I think it is astonishing. Yes, you have a question.
How effective have you found this with physician compliance, or do you even allow physicians access?
We don't actually let the physicians have access. What has happened a couple times is I'll get a call on a weekend. You know, I came in, my wife hurt her wrist, I need a wristband. So, I have to give my code. Yes, but realistically, that's up to your practice, I think. But you certainly run the error. But the good news is if you did go with that route, which you certainly could, you would know which physician took it because he put his code in there. And so you could say, I saw you took a brace on Saturday, what's going on? So.
Do your charges pass from the system to the practice management?
It can. We haven't implemented it yet. So we're still
doing data entry.
We're still a little scared to jump into that. But that ultimately is the goal. So once it, right now we're doing it, putting on charge ticket, and we're doing the cross reference. But ultimately we want it just once it's assigned and posted. So. Any other questions? So I think. Again, what I'm supposed to do in this format is I'm supposed to have you guys pick one of these, break you off in small work groups, you guys do a little work, and then we kind of discuss it individually. I'm worried about that format in an hour, and we can certainly do that, or we can just walk through each one of these and kind of talk amongst ourselves as a group. It's a pretty packed room here, so I don't think we can move everybody around. Do we just want to go with that route?
Yes. Okay.
I like that. So we'll just go through these. Patient communication, patient reminder. So portal usage, history forms, medication refill, forms, patient communication, patient reminders. Is anyone using anything particular that they want to share? A good experience with this patient communication stuff online? I know for us, the portals, we're multi-specialty, so our OBGYN portal usage is awesome, right? Everybody fills, they take the time to fill out the portal and they communicate. Orthopedics, we've struggled a little bit. I kind of attribute it to, it's an episode of 6 weeks. I'm getting my wrist, I broke it, I'm getting it fixed, I'm done. Now I'm gonna see you the next time I need to see you. So is anyone having great success with the portal they want to share? And if so, how are you doing it or anything? And that's, are you having a similar response as we're having? Yes, ma'am.
Well, so we went on Twitter VMware last year. We implemented portal at the end of August. But when we implemented the portal, we also, and this will kind of tie in your kiosk question as well, we went on eClinicalWorks and we took their kiosk technology and stretched it to the max. So we were actually completely paperless at the front desk. We used the kiosk for all of the intake at our front desk, but that also translates to our portal. So we're really pushing portal because the patients don't want to fill out the kiosks or they want to get the paperwork filled out before they come in. So anything that we did on the kiosk pushes over to our portal as well. So our appointment scheduling department web enables them and encourages them to go on and fill out their paperwork to expedite their time in the office. So we have about 40% of our patients actually signing up for the portal. So we're doing pretty good with it, and the patients are using it. They're sending messages to the providers. So we've actually, I don't know if it's just our population or, and I know that that seems to be an anomaly. People don't seem to like the portal, but.
Are they signing up prior to visit? You're offering it?
Appointment scheduling offers it to them, whether it enables them, and talks to them about filling out the paperwork on the portal.
And it's three clinical?
Yeah.
Sure. Good. One more question. If we wait until we get the mic, it might help. And I think they're recording this.
Just a comment. So two years ago or so, when everybody was rushing to have a certain amount of patients on the portal, what we were able to do at holiday time, we employed all the physicians' kids who were home from college, and they did self-interviews of patients to get the portal engagement numbers up. So that was one of the methods we used, because it is awkward for some people, but you know, you got to do everything you can to try and get the portal yourself up.
Yeah.
We have a portal. We automatically enroll patients if their email is in there upon charge submission. Our EHR lets us do that, so that works really pretty well. We also happen to have two rheumatologists in our group. Their enrollment is 80%, and the orthopedic GARP is less than 10.
Yeah.
So it's all about desire and motivation,
right.
I think.
Yeah. Good. Any other thoughts, comments on this? This is probably one of the least, we've lived this innovation for a while here. So the next case study really is patient check-in tablets, kiosks. It sounds like you're doing a little bit of that. I know there's a bunch of vendors out here. This is something we're looking into internally of implementing. Do you do a tablet? Do you do a kiosk? Yeah, Phreesia, Seamless, there's different models. Are you doing payment collections through that? Charge order file? And really the big question is, has it helped? You know, has it helped you collect more money, patient responsibility? I think that's the big thing Phreesia promotes from that standpoint. So does anybody use this or had success with any of these that they want to share?
We use Phreesia. We've been on Phreesia for, I don't know, probably 2-3 years now. So when the patient comes in, they're given the Phreesia pad. They go through the questions on the tablet and answer everything on the tablet. It automatically uploads into our EMR. All the data uploads discreetly into the EMR, and then they're registered. And there is a way, just recently Phreesia added this functionality. I think we've only had it for a few months, where now the patient can go on our website and there's a link and they can do the tablet online, so they don't have to do it when they come in.
Have you noticed, do they do payment on the
phone? And that's the other thing, yeah, they can do their payment on the Phreesia as well as a payment plan set up on the Phreesia.
And you can set like blocks so that they can't get past that. They have to say,
yes,
you know, I'll make a payment plan of $5.
Yes, exactly.
And what EMR are you using?
Allscripts.
Can I ask a question? Has it either reduced the amount of check-in staff that you've had or drastically improved your patient collections? Because I don't want to pay the money
right.
if I can't reduce staff or get more money.
Right.
It's not worth it for me.
Well, for us, it didn't reduce staff because we were in the middle of a large growth spurt. We were adding like 6 doctors and another office, and so it just enabled us to not hire as much, which is basically the same thing. As far as the collections, that's hard to tell. We had really strong collection protocols in place at the front desk. As far as that, we have looked at the stats as far as how many patients are willing to pay on the pad, Because basically the way we set it up for them, and I won't go into the whole story why, is they can pay on the pad if they want to. If not, then they do end up having to go to the front desk and talk with the person and pay before they're allowed to go on and see the provider. And so we've kind of looked at that, and we're still having a population of patients that choose to not pay on the pad and go back to the desk and have a conversation. But we find over time the percentage shifts and more do the pad as they get comfortable and used to it. You have those patients that are just getting nervous about doing their credit card in the pad or putting information in the pad. Yeah.
I mean, the one benefit they explain is that it's consistent message. You know, you can work with your staff, but they may, if they're busy, they may not ask the same question. Phreesia, it's, or whatever system you use, it's going to always ask for the bank. Mm-hmm. And then have it, you know, have an option to come up and pay if they don't want to pay online. Any other thoughts, comments on the kiosk?
Yeah. For those that have done it, have you seen any reduction of staff at your front desk?
So he asked, for those who have done it, have you seen any reduction of staff in your front desk? So she had said that when they did it, they were in a they didn't reduce any staff, but they were in a tremendous growth pattern and they didn't have to add staff. So essentially the same thing. I don't know anybody else. Who's all using a tablet? And how many are using Phreesia? One? Two? Okay. So what, I don't want to call you out, but what system are you using?
We use a system, Vroom
at the end.
We use a system called
Epion.
Epion? Yeah, yes, Epion.
It does not collect money the way that Phreesia does, but it does a lot of the other stuff very similarly.
Is it an Athena product or is it a third
it's
party?
It's an Athena partner.
Okay.
Moving from our staff at the front desk using paper and, you know, entering information manually, where we're offloading that, but we still have a huge Medicare population in our geographic area, so we still have a lot of questions, a lot of issues that come up. The thing that we really have found, though, is while we didn't reduce staff, we made better use of the time of the staff.
Right.
So instead of getting that sheet of partially filled out paper that's illegible, half filled out, if half filled out, in a lot of circumstances. So they're getting back to the room now, and the patient has done the information, they've entered the stuff that needs to be entered. We've offloaded the work of gathering that information that we need from our nurse or our MA in that room, and we've kind of pushed that up to the front desk. So when they come back there, that information is pulled over into the EMR, it's come across as discrete data, and we're really ready to go through and say, all right, let me flip through this, let me run through, let me make sure there's no alarms that I'm seeing or anything that I need to make a decision on, so that we're moving people through the clinic faster,
right,
because we're getting it before they ever step back into the clinic.
Are you using tablets or kiosks?
Tablets.
And have you had any, I mean, I've heard this concern from groups, is how do you keep track of it?
Honestly, you have a number of them, you know, and at the end of the day, it's just a tablet.
You have lost that.
None of them have walked away. I mean, they're in a big, ugly case.
Right, yeah, that helps.
It's kind of obvious if you walk off of one. But at the end of the day, I mean, it's nothing but an internet-connected device. None of them lives on the tablet, so even if you steal all of them that I've got, you just have a bunch of dumb iPads that are locked up.
Right, right. Yeah.
And the company's liable to replace them if I lose.
The Phreesia tablet is a 100% Phreesia tablet. Nobody would want it.
Right.
It's not going to do anything for you. It truly just runs the Phreesia software. It's not like your normal like iPad tablet. So it has no value for anybody outside the practice. So you really don't have to worry about it. Plus, it's kind of large and obnoxious, so it'd be hard to walk away with. So that's not an issue there. For us, the other thing I forgot to mention, the big thing for us with going with the tablet and the data feeding in discreetly into Allscripts is we used it to handle very close to almost all of our MUPQRS requirements where the staff didn't have to deal with it anymore. We loaded all of that question and work onto the patient in the Phreesia pad, and so then when it uploaded discreetly into Allscripts, pretty much we were nailing the MUPQRS without the staff doing anything.
Well, in effort and sensitive at time, and there's probably some other case studies, we want to carry on to the next and see what. So satisfaction surveys, yeah, again, are you using them? Implementing them through your systems. I'm sure you know how many people are doing them right now. And are they all electronic or some paper?
Electronic.
So I guess, you know, we probably don't want to spend a lot of time. You're probably using certain systems at work. But I guess the question I would have is, what are you doing with the data? You know, are you sharing it with your physicians? How many people are sharing it with just their physician? Are you unblinding everything with all your physicians? Some are, some aren't. You know, one of the challenges, I think, you know, and I'm on the benchmark committee for AOE, so I think there's a tremendous value of what if, you know, why don't we have a benchmark for patient satisfaction, just so you could show, because I'll have my spine surgeon say, well, my numbers are low, but all spine patients are crabby, and you know, I can't really, right? And so if I had spine data benchmarking to compare it to, now the biggest challenge with patient satisfaction is what survey, right? There's a million different surveys. So would there be value in that if there was some type of benchmark in that? And there was, even if it's standard five questions, because that would help me help my spine doctor that probably does, may or may not have the best communication skill. Anything else we want, any other concerns, thoughts on patient satisfaction? I think that's kind of an older innovation, so we can go on to the next. So this is another one, patient outcomes. How many people are doing outcomes? And are you using, so about almost half the room maybe? Are you using, how many people are doing who's true screeners? What's that? Yeah. Yeah, the other, anybody doing the CAPS? Yeah, they're challenging. And what are you using a vendor? Anybody using a particular vendor that they like?
Code technology?
For who's screener?
Yeah, we do outcome surveys on all surgical procedures.
Good. All right. And what are you doing today?
At this point, we're probably 6 months, 9 months in. So at this point, collecting it to determine baselines.
Yeah.
What are you collecting the data for? How are you? What's your workflow for collecting
it initially? Code technology has a nice process in the sense that all we do is we provide the code just has a nice process in the sense that we just provide the patient information and the surgeon procedure, and they send out the surveys, they do the follow up, and they provide us the data.
Electronically.
They also do phone calls that they kind of have to follow up with the patient. Our response rate is about 85%.
Anybody else using anything that they like? We actually did who's the screener. We actually just had a person call in between, and we're just doing it on, you know, just the time signatures and needs, the total joints. And we're just putting it in a database at this point. That's something we'd like to benchmark too. In the data analytics committee of AOE is could we benchmark our who's to's as well so we could have some standardized and narrow it down by, you know, just like we can do the benchmarking data now with the practice size, geographic location, and specialty as well. So, yes?
Just a thought, you mentioned incorporating it in your survey. Could AOS reach out to the major companies that do surveys and say, can you include these five questions and see if we can get some consensus that way?
Yeah, obviously you guys are members of AOE and there's a lot of opportunity and there's a tremendous amount of sharing of data, right? And from that standpoint, what you could do as an organization of AOE is it's tremendous advocacy, right? Having that information to help us design policy moving forward. So, yeah, we want to be agnostic to the vendor. We just want to be a collection area. So if we could get some standardized five questions, and Obert does it, and Binary Fountain does it, and someone else does it, that's great. You know, AOE doesn't want to be the collection tool, right? But if we could be a repository to all pose that and house that, and share it and benchmark against it, it would be tremendous. So, and we'll probably, if we get down that road, the board's taking us down that road, is we're going to need, you know, people who use these vendors to help. And the vendors want to work with AOE potentially, but they also want to own it, right? And so it's your data, though, right? It's your outcome. So, yeah, your question?
As far as who's, the AJRR just surpassed 1 million data points.
I saw that, yeah.
I mean, they're also going to be a great data source for benchmark for the AOI.
Yeah, so he said that AJRR, the registry for the WHOSCOOS just passed 1 million. I don't know if you saw that, but that's a tremendous amount of data. And this is where we can help influence policy change, hopefully. So. Any other thoughts, questions? Good. I think this is our last one, and we're at a little early here. So we've got some time to kind of follow back up on some of these as well. But this after-hours walking clinic, and we implemented, we have two of them in Signature. We had one that opened about 3 years ago. And we have five, in this division of ours, we have five pediatric orthopedic surgeons, and a bunch of adults, but it's on the campus of the hospital, literally right down the hall from the ER. And we opened one up and we thought it'd be very interesting to see the response rate, and it just exploded. And so we actually maxed it out at 18. We don't see more than 18 a night. We're open Monday through Friday, 5:30 to 8:30. Saturday, we're open from 9 to 2:30. We're not open on Sundays, mainly staffing challenges, but ideally we need to be open on Sundays because a lot of kids play sports. Our biggest growth, is probably 80% kids, right, pediatrics, because they're the ones doing stuff in the evenings and weekends. We opened another one up in October in a different market, only one pediatric surgeon, kind of off the beaten path, and it's been a much slower growth process. We've had to do a little more marketing for it, but it's starting to ramp up now that spring came around and people are getting outside. October is probably the worst time to open it, and we knew that. But we had the staff available to do it. So who else is offering this? Yeah, so it's, and you want to share any thoughts, concerns, kind of how you staff it, anything like that?
I'd like to ask a question. We run 8 to 8 Monday through Friday. It's been a tremendous success for us, and I'm trying to pitch doing a Saturday clinic. So I'd like to know how you staff your Saturday clinic, what hours, and did you notice a difference on your Saturday hours, the difference in running a Monday through Friday clinic?
We started with Saturdays, so we staffed it. It's from one clinic is 8:30 to 2, and the other one's 9 to 2, and that's really just a staff. We're staffing with PAs, the doctor on call is available. We got digital X-ray, the doctor can log in and see if there's a question from that standpoint. We really have had similar response from volume. From that standpoint, obviously fall sports season seems to be a little more busy, which you'd expect, but I think where we missed the boat are Sundays, truthfully, because in St. Louis, select soccer and those sports are just going crazy on the weekends, so we lose that opportunity, but we don't have the manpower to open it up on Sundays. Yep.
Question, any limiting, see anything, just new acute injuries, no more
we can see work comp. We don't see a lot of it at this point. We usually don't see below 2 years old. That's just kind of the comfort level standpoint. We try not to see follow-up patients. Sometimes you'll have a patient come in that kind of abuses the system a little bit. So we'll see them once, but they have to see a physician after that. So you kind of play around at that standpoint.
How are you? Are you leasing space with the hospital?
No, so we have a clinic. It's in the building. They have a medical arts in the building, the one. So we just use our own clinic. That's the best part about these, for those of you that don't do this, is you're really just leveraging your fixed cost. Because your building's sitting there costing you after hours. Your x-ray's sitting there costing you. So the only cost is labor. So we have, and for us at our one clinic, we have an MRI that we run until 9 o'clock at night as well. So we use the MRI receptionist. And so all our staff is just a medical assistant or a PA and an x-ray tech. And so we really have it's a very low break even to cover your cost. And that's if you're just counting the bills that you charge. We don't, from a financial standpoint, we don't track and count the surgeries we get out. We're just looking at the visits and the charges and the DMEs we generate from the visit. Yes, sir.
We elected to do something a little bit different. We just thought walk-in clinics was challenging from a marketing and staffing perspective.
Right.
So we just looked at, on Mondays and Thursday nights, we stayed open until 7:30 just for new patients only.
Yep.
So their schedule is not a walk-in clinic, but that's been very successful for us. I can tell you we've been doing it for about a year and a half, and there's been a handful of evening hours that haven't been filled. So it's been good for us.
And I will say, that's how we started out. We started out Tuesday and Thursdays, late hours with the doc. And just to kind of get the doctors comfortable with that. Because they didn't think patients would come. And your exact example is that they're full.
Yeah. What time do you close on your other days?
The last person scheduled.
You have a question right here?
Are you staffing with primarily mid-levels, or are you also using physicians?
Right now, we just primarily mid-levels. We have one physician that is slowing down and is expressed interest in covering a couple shifts. I know some clinics do that. Yours might, I'm not sure. But mostly it's mid-levels.
And when you launched, how did you market?
So the pediatric one, we literally sent one mailer out to all the pediatric practices, and it just, that was it. Now the other one, in more of a remote scenario, we didn't. We thought we were didn't have to because we didn't deal with the other one, and it got slow. So we had to do a little more marketing, some online stuff, some AdWords stuff, and referring doctors as well. But and then it starts to grow word of mouth. You know, patients realize I can go there and pay a copay versus paying my $500, $600 deductible at the ER. So, and the weird thing about what we've experienced is the one with the ER right next to the ER, we've actually had patients, they send patients down sometimes because if they're slammed and someone's in for a wrist fracture, they'll just send them down anyhow. So we didn't think that would be the case. And we've had a few urgent cares do that as well. The urgent cares probably are the most upset with the models just because they make money off the orthopedics. Yep.
We actually amped ours up by doing sports physicals, so we charge $10 and
we do sports physicals, we charge $10 and kids, tons of kids come in. I mean, it gets crazy. We have to overstaff now at that point. But I guess we'll work out there.
Do you offer them all the time or certain times? All the time?
9 to 9, 7 days a week.
The clinical, the sports physical? Yeah.
Do you have your PAs follow the non-surgical in the walk-in, or does everything get deferred to the regular clinic?
Yeah, we just, it's supposed to be a one visit, and they have to see the doctor within 10 days. And then we have the doctor on call, reviews the x-rays the next morning, just to make sure something wasn't missed. And we've had a couple times where, you know, when the kids with the growth plates, something could get missed, and we call them and they can't come back down.
Have you had any challenges with primary care or referral physicians just sending patients over to urgent care versus going through the referral process and getting them booked on a physician schedule?
Not too much. I mean, we're really trying to just promote trauma. I mean, we've had a little bit of it, but not tremendous at this point. So that is a concern, though, with the referral part. I think we had a question back there. And I think that's where, you know, we have, even his point was, it seems like patients are just going to go to the evenings because it's convenient. Well, that's exactly what, I mean, we have to remember who our customers are, right? And expectations have changed from the baby boomers to the younger generation. So, you know, I think from that standpoint, it's going to happen either way. And that was the classic thing about when we started one in a different area of St. Louis, it got busy right away. Well, the lower one, the more conservative doctors didn't want it. We didn't have as many PAs and NPs. They were resistant to do it until they found out that the referring doctors in that community were sending patients up just to avoid the, especially the managed care stuff and all that, they were sending up. So we were, as soon as they realized that, you know, patients were going to go elsewhere, you know, we're going to open it tomorrow.
Are you doing that as a physician office?
Yes. There's a code, there's an after hours code. I'm not a coder, but I think it's like a $25 extra fee. We put that on there. I don't know if you guys were doing it or anyone else is doing that. If it was argued, we'd probably write it off.
So then are you also, it sounds to me like most people who are doing this are not limiting it to acute injuries. It's just extended hours.
Well, we promoted this after hours emergency care. I mean, we want it to be acute. We don't want someone that had chronic knee pain to come in. Now, when we turn them away, we haven't technically. We've maybe turned, if we're busy slammed with a bunch of acute, we would turn it away. But, you know, we haven't had a lot of abuse with just chronic pain. We've actually had mostly acute injuries. So.
Do you encounter managed care referral issues?
Yeah, that was kind of what you were referring to a little bit, maybe. We haven't had much issues with that standpoint, for the managed care referrals. I think you have a question.
Same thing. Okay. In our market, that would be an issue.
It would be an issue.
Did anyone go to the state and try to get licensure at public health at a different level than an office?
We haven't tried. Right, we haven't tried to be like certified as an urgent care. And really, it's a catch-22 in my opinion. Is we're trying to offer a low-cost service, so if we start to get up into the urgent care billing side, yeah, it'd be great from a financial standpoint, but is that really, do we, you know, do we want to compete or do we want to offer a low-cost service to our patients? So that's what our, in our market, we, there's so many employed physicians, we have to differentiate ourselves pretty dramatically from a cost standpoint. Yes, sir.
Yeah, the managed care referral, they're usually pretty predictable, like for us at Cigna.
Right.
So what we did is we just contacted our Cigna rep and let them know we were opening the urgent care, and they gave us a 24-hour waiver.
Right.
So as long as we get that referral within 24 hours, and they have to do it.
And that's what we check it, and we call it the next morning. Try to get the referral. We haven't had really any denials from that standpoint. You may want to do it and double check from that standpoint. I mean, it would be insane for them not, because they're saving a tremendous amount.
Money.
Absolutely. So, yeah.
So are you using the same 10
yep.
as your office?
Yep, same tax ID as we do. It's just like, it really is just like seeing us, except it's just extended out, essentially, for emergent conditions, ideally.
And do you see Medicaid?
The plans were on, yeah. Any other questions, comments? Yeah.
Do you
have
to contract
them with the federal agency? Yes. The plans that will contract them, we credential them under that. Right now, the question was, do we narrow what insurance plans we see in our after hours from what our normal day? Right now, we honor all the ones we're currently in contract with. So. Well, good. This was good. I was glad. Any other questions? Hopefully, this was beneficial. I'm not sure if we did exactly how we're supposed to do it, but I think we've got good interaction. Certainly, I appreciate that. So, thank you guys, and have a great evening. You need to do anything?
Just remember.